as we roll down some familiar road. And although this way is stringing us along, just know you're not alone. Cause I'm gonna make this place your
now, Friend Paula, our nuptial honor draws on apace. Four happy days bring in another moon. Oh, methinks how slow this old moon wanes. She lingers my desires to the stepdame, my dowager, and long withering out a young man's revenue.
4 days will quickly seek themselves as night. 4 nights will quickly dream away the time. And the moon, like to a silver bow, new bent in heaven, shall behold the night of our solemnity.
Go, Philistrate, serve the Athenian youth commandments. Awake the pert and nimble spirit of mirth. Oh, and turn melancholy forth to funerals. Pale companions, not for our pomp. Ah, Paula, I wooed thee with my sword, and I won thy love to win the injuries. I'll wed thee in another key. With pomp, with triumph, and with reveling.
Happy be Theseus, our renowned duke.
Thanks, good Aegeus. What's the news with thee?
Full of vexation come I. Complaint is my child, my daughter, Hermia. Stand forth, Demetrius, my noble lord. This man has my consent to marry her. Stand forth, Lysander, and my gracious duke. This man has bewitched the bosom of my child. Thou, Lysander, thou hast given her rhymes and interchanged love tokens with my child. Thou hast by moonlight at her window sung, with fading voice versus fading love, and stolen the impression of her fantasy. Replaced to thy hair, rings, messengers, a strong commitment in unhardened youth. And be so she, stand here before your grace, consent to marry with Demetrius. I beg the ancient privilege of Athens, as she is mine, I may dispose of her. To either this gentleman, or to her death, according to the law, immediately provided in that case.
What say you, fair Hermia? Be advised, fair Hermia. To you, your father should be as a god, one who composed of your beauties, yes, and one to whom you are but a form in wax, by him imprinted, and within his power to leave the figure or disfigure it. And Demetrius is a worthy gentleman.
So is Lysander.
In himself he is, but in this kind, wanting your father's voice, the other must be held the worthier.
I would my father looked with my eyes.
Rather, your eyes must with his judgment look.
I do entreat your grace to pardon me. I know not by what power I am made bold, nor how it may concern my modesty. In such a presence here to plead my thoughts, but I beseech your grace that I may know the worst that may befall me. In this case, if I refuse to wed Demetrius.
Either to die the death or to absorb forever in the society of men. Therefore, fair Hermia, question your desires. Know of your youth, examine all your blood. If you yield not to your father's choice, you can endure the livery of a nun. To live a barren sister all your life, chanting faint hymn to the cold fruitless moon. To undergo such maiden pilgrimage? But earthlier happy is the rose distilled. Then that which withering on the virgin thorn grows, lives, and dies in single blessing.
So will I grow, so live, so die, my lord. Before I will yield my virgin packed up unto his lordship, whose unwished yoke my soul consents not to give sovereignty.
Take time to pause. By the next new moon, on the sealing day betwixt my love and me, for everlasting bond of fellowship. Upon that day, either prepare to die for disobedience to your father's will, or to wed Demetrius as he would, or on Diana's altar to protest her high austerity and single life.
Relent, sweet Hermia. Lysander, yield thy crazed title to my certain right.
You have her father's love, Demetrius. Let me have hers. Do you marry him?
Scornful Lysander. True, he hath my love. And what if my friends are Sam and she is mine, and all I see all to Demetrius?
I am, my lord, as well derived as he, as well possessed. My love is more than his. My fortune's every way as fair than right, not as advantaged as Demetrius's. And which is more than all these boasts can be. I'm beloved of beauty, Tony. Why should not I then prosecute my right? Demetrius, I love out to his head, made love to Netter's daughter, Helena, and won her soul. And she, sweet lady, dotes, devoutly dotes, dotes in idolatry upon this spotted and inconstant man.
I must confess, I've heard so much, and with Demetrius, not to have spoke thereof, but being overfull of self-affairs, my mind did lose it. But Demetrius, come, and come, Aegeus, shall go with me. I have some private schooling for you both. As for you, fair Hermit, look you on yourself to fit your fancies to your father's will, or else the law of Athens yields you up, which by no means we may extenuate. To death, or to a vow of single life. Come, Apollo. What cheer, my love? Demetrius and Aegeus go along. I must confer with you of some business against our nuptials, and confer with you of something that nearly concerns yourselves.
Duty and desire to follow you.
How now, my love? Why is your cheek so pale? How chance the roses that do fade so fast?
Be life for want of rain. Try to well beteem them from the tempest to my eyes.
Me. For aught that I could ever read, could ever tell by tale or history, the course of true love never did run smooth. But either it was different in blood,
cross too high to be enthralled too low,
or else it was misgrafted in respect of
youth, oh, spite too old to be engaged too young,
or else it stood upon the choice of friends.
Oh, how to choose love behind another's eyes!
Or, if there were sympathy in choice, war, death, or sickness did lay siege to it, making it momentary as a sound, swift as a shadow, short as any dream, brief as the lightning of the calling night, and before a man hath the power to say, behold, the jaws of darkness did devour it up. So quick bright things come to be.
If then true lovers have been ever crossed, it stands as needed in destiny. Then let us teach our child patience, because it is a customary cross, as due to love as thoughts and dreams and sighs, wishes and tears, poor fancy's followers.
A good persuasion. Therefore, hear me, Hermit. I have a widow aunt, a dowager of great revenue, and she hath no child. From Athens is her house remote 7 leagues, and she respects me as her only son. There, gentle Hermia, may I marry thee. And to that place, the sharper thing than thou cannot pursue us. If thou lovest me then, leave thy father's house tomorrow night, and in the wood, a league without the town, where I did meet thee once with Helena, to who was ever so mortal man. There will I wait for thee.
My good Lysander, I swear to thee by Cupid's strongest bow, by his best arrow with the golden head, by the simplicity of Venus' doves, by that which knitteth souls and prospereth loves, and by that fire which burned the Carthage queen when the false Trojan under sail was seen, by all the vows that ever men have broke, in number more than ever women spoke, in that same place thou hast appointed me, tomorrow truly will I meet with thee.
Keep promise, wife. Look, here comes Helena.
Godspeed, fair Helena. Whither away?
Call you me fair? That fair again unsay. Demetrius loves your fair. Oh, happy fair. Your eyes are lodestars. Your tongue, sweet air, more tunable than lark to shepherd's ear. When wheat is green, when hawthorn buds appear, sickness is catching. Oh, we're fair so. Yours would I catch, fair Hermia, before I go. My ear should catch your voice, my eye, your eye. My tongue should catch your tongue's sweet melody. Were the world mine, Demetrius being fated, the rest I'd give to you to be translated. Oh, teach me how you look, with what art you sway the motion of Demetrius's heart.
I frown upon him, yet he loves me still.
Oh, that your frowns could teach my smiles such skill.
I give him curses, yet he gives me love.
Oh, that my prayers could such affection move.
The more I hate, the more he follows me.
The more I love, the more he hateth me.
His fault, Helena, is no fault of mine.
None but your beauty, would that fault were mine.
Take comfort, he no more shall see my face. Lysander and myself will fly this place.
silvery visage in the watery glass, decking with liquid pearl the bladed grass, and signed with lover's flights that still conceal the Rathen's gates we've devised to steal.
It's in the wood where often you and I, upon fate primrose beds, are wont to lie, emptying our bosoms of their counsel sweet. There my Lysander and myself will meet, and then to mountains turn away our eyes to seek new friends and stranger companies. Oh, farewell, sweet Plato. Pray thou for us, and good luck grant thee, thy Demetrius. Keep word, Lysander, we must starve our sight from lovers through tomorrow's eight midnight.
I will, my Hermia.
Helena,
continue. As you want him, Demetrius dote on you.
How happy some or other some can be. Through Athens, I am thought as fair as she. But what of that? Demetrius thinks not so. He will not know what all but he do know. And so he errs, doting on Hermia's eye. So I, admiring of his qualities, things base and vile, holding no quantity, love can transpose to form and dignity. Love looks not with the eye, but with the mind. Therefore is winged Cupid painted blind, nor hath love's mind of any judgment taste. Wings and no eyes figure unheedy haste. Therefore is love said to be a child, for in choice he is so oft beguiled. As waggish boys in game themselves forswear, the boy love is purged everywhere. For before Demetrius looked on Hermia's eye, he hailed down oaths that he were only mine. And when this hail some heat from Hermia felt, so he dissolved, and showers of oaths did melt. I will go tell him of fair Hermia's flight, and to the woods will he tomorrow night pursue her. And for this intelligence, if I have thanks, it is a dear expense, but herein mean I to enrich my pain, to have his sights thither and back again.
Is all our men here?
You were best to call them general?
Man by man?
According to the script?
Here's a scroll of every man's name, which is thought fit through all Athens to declare an interview for the Duke and Duchess on his wedding day at night.
First, good Peter Quince, say what the play treats on, then read the names of the actors, and so grow to a point.
Our play is the most lamentable comedy, and the most cruel death of Pyramus and Thisbe.
Very good piece of work, I assure you. And a merry. Now, good Peter Quince, call forth your actors by the scroll. Masters, spread yourselves.
Answer as I call you. Nick Bottom, class of 2013.
Oh, seniors! Ready? Name what pot I am for, Empress.
You, Nick Bottom, are set down for Pyramus.
What is Pyramus? A lover or a tyrant?
A lover that kills himself most gallantly in love.
That will last in tears in the true performing of it. If I do it, let the audience look to their eyes. I will move storms. I will condole in some measure. Yet my chief humor is of a tyrant. I could play Hercules rarely, or a part to tear a cannon to make all split. The rage in rocks and shivering shocks shall break the locks of prison gates. And Phoebus' car shall shine from far and make and mar the foolish fates. This was lofty. Now, name the rest of the players. This is Hercules' bane, a tyrant's bane. A lover is more condoling.
Francis Flute, sophomore.
Here, Peter Quince.
You, Flute, are to take Thisbe on you.
What is Thisbe? A wandering knight.
It is the lady that Pyramus was on.
Nay, Faith, let me not play a woman. I have a beer cup.
That's all wanting. You may play it in your mask, but and you can speak as small as you will.
Oh, and I may hide my face. Let me play Thisbe too. I will speak in a monstrous voice. Thisbe! Thisbe!
Demetrius. I love her dear. Thy Thisbe dear. And lady dear.
No, no, you must play Pyramus and flute you Thisbe. Robin Starling, Jr.
Here, Peter Prince.
You are to play Thisbe's mother. Tom Snout, Sr.
Here, Peter Prince.
You, Pyramus's father. Myself, Thisbe's father. Snout, the lion's part, and here I hope is a play well fitted.
Have you the lion's part written? Pray you, if it be, give it me, for I am slow of study.
It is nothing but roaring.
Oh, let me play the lion too. I will roar that it will do any man's heart good to hear me. I will roar that it'll make the Duke say, let him roar again. Let him roar again.
And you should do it too terribly, and you would frighten the Duchess and ladies, and that were enough to hang us all.
It would be ostracized.
You ostrich!
I grant you, friends, if that you should fright the ladies out of their wits, they would have no more discretion but to hang us. But I will aggravate my voice, so that I will roar you as gently as any sucking dove. I will roar you as if it were any nightingale.
But you must play Pyramus, for Pyramus is a sweet-faced man, a proper man, as much as he says today, a most lovely, gentleman-like man. And that is why you must needs play Pyramus.
Well, I will undertake it. What beard would I best to play it in?
Why, what you will.
I will discharge neither your straw-colored beard, your orange tawny beard, your purple ingrain beard, or your French crown colored beard. You're a perfect yellow.
Some of your French crowns have no hair at all. Then you shall play a bare face. But, masters, I am to entreat you, desire you, and pray you, conjure your lion's part tomorrow night. We'll meet in the palace woods a mile without the town, for if we meet in the city, we'll be dogged by company and our devices known. I will draw up a bill of property, such as our play suggests. Masters, I pray you, fail me not.
We will meet, and there may we rehearse most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect. Adieu.
At the Duke's Oak we meet.
Enough! Hold your cut bowstrings!
Skim milk and sometimes
slave her in the quirk, and bootless make the breathless housewives churn, and sometimes make the drink to banner barm, mislead night wanderers, laughing at their harm. Those that hobgoblin call you in, sweet puck, you do their work, and they shall have good luck. Are you not he?
Thou speak'st aright. I am that merry wanderer of the night. I jest to Oberon and make him smile, when a fat and bean-fed horse beguile, neighing in likeness of a filly foal. And sometime I lurk in a gossip's pole, in very likeness of a roasted crab. And when she drinks, against her lips I bob, and on her withered dewlap pour the ale. The wisest aunt, telling the saddest tale, sometime for 3-foot stool mistaketh me. I slip from her bum, and down topples she. And Taylor cries and falls into a cough, and the whole choir hold their hips and laugh, and waxen in their mirth and knees, and swear a merrier hour was never wasted there. Room, fairy, here comes Oberon.
And here my mistress. Would that he were gone.
Met by moonlight, proud Titania.
What? Jealous, Oberon? Fairies, skip hence. I have forsworn his bed and company.
Tarry, rash wanton. Am not I thy lord?
I must be thy lady. But I know that thou hast stolen away from the fairy land and in the shape of Corin sat all day, playing with pipes of corn and verses of love to amorous Phillida. Why art thou here? Come from the furthest steppe of India? But that, forsooth, the bouncing Amazon, your buskined mistress, and your warrior love, to Theseus, must be wedded, and you come to give their bed joy and prosperity.
How canst thou thus for shame, Titania, glance at my credit with Hippolyta, knowing I know thy love for Theseus? Didst thou not lead him through the glimmering night from Perigenia, and make him with fair Aegle break his faith with Ariadne in Antiope?
These are the forgeries of jealousy, and never, since the middle summer spring, met we on hill, in dale, forest, or mead, by paved brook, or rushy fountain, or in the beach margin of the sea, to dance our ringlets in the whistling wind. But with thy brawls thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore the wind, piping to us in vain, as in revenge hath sucked up from the sea contagious fogs, which, falling on the land, have made every pelting river so proud that they have overborne their continents. The human mortals lack their winter here. No night is with him or carol blessed. Therefore the moon, the governess of floods, pale in her anger, washes all the air that rheumatic diseases do abound. And it is through this distemperament that we see the seasons alter. The spring, the summer, the childing autumn, and the angry winter change their wonted liveries, and by their increase, the mazed world knows not which is which. And this same progeny of evils comes from our debate, our dissension. We are the parents and the originals.
Do you lament it then? It lies in you. Why should Titania cross her over? I do but beg a little changeling boy to be my henchman.
Set your heart at rest. The fairy land buys not the child of me. His mother was a priestess in my order, and in the spiced Indian air by night, full often has she gossiped by my side, and with me sat on Neptune's yellow sands, marking the embarked traders on the flood, when we have laughed to see the sails conceive and grow big-bellied with the wanton wind. She, with pretty and swimming gait following, her womb then rich with my young squire, would imitate and sail upon the land to fetch me trifles and return as from a voyage rich with merchandise. But she, being mortal, of that boy did die. And for her sake do I rear up the boy, and for her sake I will not part with him.
How long within this wood intend you stay?
Perchance till after Theseus' wedding day. If you will patiently dance in our rounds and see our moonlight revels, go with us. If not, shun me, and I will spare your loss.
Give me that boy, I'll go with thee.
Not for thy fairy kingdom. Fairies away, we shall chide downright if I longer stay.
Well, go thy way. Thou shalt not from this grove till I torment thee for this injury. My gentle pup, come hither. Thou rememberest, since once I sat upon a promontory and heard a mermaid on the dolphin's back, uttering such a dulcet and harmonious breath that the rude sea was civil at her song, and certain stars shot madly from their spears to hear the sea maid's music. I remember that very time I saw what thou couldst not fly between the cold moon and earth, Cupid, all armed, a certain aim he took in a fair vestal thrown by the west, and loosed his love shaft from one of the rumblings, as it should pierce 100,000 hearts. But I might see young Cupid's fiery shaft quenched in the chaste beams of the watery moon, and the imperial waters passed on. In maiden meditation, fancy free, yet marked I where the bolt of Cupid fell. It fell upon a little western flower, before milk white, now purple with love's wounds, and maidens call it love and diabetes. Fetch me that flower, the herb I showed thee once. The juice of it on sleeping eyelids laid will make or man or woman madly dote with the next live creature that it sees. Fetch me that herb and be thou here again ere the Leviathan can swim the lead. I'll put a girdle round above the earth in 40 minutes. Having once this juice, I'll watch Titania as she sleeps, and drop the liquor of it on her eyes. Then, the next thing she waking looks upon, be it a lion, bear, wolf, or bull, unmeddling monkey or busy ape, she shall pursue it with the soul of love. And dare I take this charm off of her sight, as I can with another herb, I'll make her render up her page to me. But who comes here? I am invisible and shall overhear their conference.
I love thee not, therefore pursue me not. Here is Lysander and fair Hermia, the one I'll slay, the other slayeth me. Thou toldest me they were stolen unto this wood, and here am I, and woed within this wood because I cannot meet my Hermia. Hence, get thee gone and follow me no more.
You draw me, you hard-hearted adamant, and yet you draw not iron, for my heart is true as steel. Leave you your power to draw, and I will have no power to follow you.
Do I entice you? Do I speak you fair? Or rather, do I not, in plainest truth, tell you I do not, nor cannot, love you?
Even for that do I love you the more. I am your spaniel, and Demetrius, the more you beat me, I will fawn on you. Use me but as your spaniel. Spurn me, strike me, neglect me, lose me. Only give me leave, unworthy as I am, to follow you.
Tempt not too much the hatred of my spirit, for I am sick when I do look unto thee.
And I am sick when I look not on you.
You do impede your modesty too much. To leave the city and commit yourselves into the hands of one that loves you not. To trust the opportunity of night and the ill counsel of a desert place with the rich worth of your virginity.
Your virtue is my privilege, for that it is not night when I do look on your face. Therefore I think I am not in the night, nor doth this wood lack worlds of company. For you, in my respect, are all the world. And how can it be said I'm alone when all the world is here to look on me?
I'll run from thee and hide me in the brakes, and leave thee to the mercy of wild beasts.
The wildest hath not such a heart as you. Run when you will. The story shall be changed. Apollo flies, and Daphne holds the chase. The dove pursues the griffin. The mild hind makes speed to catch the tiger. Bootless speed, when cowardice pursues and valor flies.
I will not stay thy questions. Let me go. Or, if thou follow me, do not believe that I will do thee mischief in the wood.
Aye, in the temple, the town, the field, you do me mischief. Fie, Demetrius! Your wrongs do set a scandal on my sex. We cannot fight for love as men may do. We should be wood and were not made to woo. I'll follow thee and make a heaven of hell to die upon the hand I love so well.
Fare thee well, then. Before he leaves this grove, you shall fly him, and he shall seek your love. Welcome, wanderer. Hast thou the flower there?
Aye, there it is.
I pray thee give it me. I know a bank where the wild thyme blows, where oxlips and nodding violet grows. There sleeps Titania sometime of the night, lulled in the flowers with dance and delight. I'll take the juice of this and streak her eyes, and make her full of hateful fantasies. Take thou some of it and seek through this grove. A sweet Athenian lady's in love with the disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, but do it when the next thing he espies is the lady. Thou shalt know the man from the Athenian garments he hath on, affected with some care that he may prove more fond on her than she upon her love, and be thou here before the first cock crow.
Fear not, my lord, your servant shall do so.
See when thou dost wake, do it for thy true love take, love and languish for his sake. Be a lion, cat, or bear, part or boar with bristled hair, in thy dream that shall appear. When thou wakest, it is thy dear, wake when some vile thing is near.
Throw all the power this charmed doth of. And
And when thou wakest, let love forbid sleep his seat on thy eyelid. Wake when I am gone, for I must now to Oberon.
Alexander?
comedy of Pyramus and Thisbe to never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword to kill himself, which the ladies cannot abide.
I'll answer you that.
Seriously, a horrible fear.
I believe we must leave the killing out when all is done.
Not a whit. I have a device to make all well. Write me a prologue, and let that prologue seem to say, we shall do no harm with our swords, and that Pyramus is not killed indeed. And for the more better assurance, tell him that I, Pyramus, am not Pyramus, but Bottom, the senior.
You see, yes!
This will put them out of their fear.
Well, we will have such a prologue, and it will be written 8 and 6.
No! Take it 2 more. Let it be written in 8 and 8.
Will not the ladies be afeared of the lion?
I fear it, I promise you.
Masters, you ought to consider with yourselves to bring in, God shield us, a lion among ladies is the most dreadful thing. For there's not a more fearful wild fowl than your lion living, and we ought to look to it.
Therefore, another prologue must tell you is not a lion.
Nay. You must name her name, and half her face must be seen through the lion's neck. And she herself must speak through, saying thus, for to the same effect. Ladies, or fair ladies, I would wish you, or I would request you, or I would entreat you, not to fear, not to tremble, my life for yours. If you think I come hither as a lion, it were a pity on my life. No, I am no such thing. I am a person as other people are. And there indeed let her name her name, and tell them plainly that she is... Snug.
Well, it shall be so, but there is 2 more things. That is, to bring moonlight into the chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe did meet by moonlight.
Does the moon shine the night we play our play?
A calendar, a calendar! Look in the almanac! Find out moonshine, find out moonshine!
Yes, it shall shine that night.
What? Then may you leave the casement of the great chamber window, where we play, open, and the moon shall shine in at the casement.
Aye, or else one must come and say they come to disfigure or present the person the moonshine. But there is another thing, that is to bring in a wall into the great chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe did talk to the chink of a wall.
But you can never bring in a wall. What say you, Bob?
Some man or other must present wall. And let him have some plaster, or some loam, or some rough cast about him to signify well. And let him hold his finger thus, and through that cranny shall Pyramus and Thisbe whisper.
Well, it shall be so. Come, everyone, rehearse your parts. Pyramus, once you've spoken your speech, enter into the towering house, and so everyone according to his cue.
What hempen homespuns have we swaggering here so near the cradle of the fairy queen? What? A play toward? I'll be an auditor, an actor too, perhaps, if I see cause.
Pyramus, speak. Thisbe, stand forth.
Thisbe, the flowers of odious savor sweet.
Odors! What? Odors.
Odors savor sweet, so hath thy breath, my dearest Thisbe dear. But hark! A voice! Stay thou but here a while, and by I will to thee. A stranger Pyramus than ever play here.
Must I speak now?
Aye, you must, for you are to understand that he is gone but to see a voice he has heard, and to come again.
Most radiant Pyramus, most lily white of you, whose color like the rainbow of the fire, most crimson top of the deep of the tree, most tallest to the stars, and the dark, and the deepest, and the best of all. And I next to you, man, God, you mustn't speak that yet, that you mentioned Pyramus. You speak all your points at once, choose not. Pyramus, your cue is past, it is never tired.
Oh, it's true as true as true.
Around, through bog, through bush, through brake,
yeehaw,
through briar, sometime a horse in the eye, sometime a hound, and I'll neigh, and bark, and hunt, and roar, like horse, hound, hog, bear, fire, and turn!
Why did they run away? This is a knavery of them today. Oh, Bun, Larachish, what do I see on thee?
What do you see? Stop acting like an ass!
Ask me, Eeyah, to frighten me if they could. But I will not stir from this place. Do what they can. I will walk up and down here, and I shall say, Eeyah, and I will, they will see I am not afraid. What about Gangnam Style?
Thank you.
her eyes, she must dote on an extremity. Here comes my messenger. How now, mad spirit? What night will now about this haunted grove?
My mistress, with a monster, is in love. Near her close and consecrated bower, while she was in her dull and sleeping hour, a crew of patches, high school students, were met together to rehearse a play intended for great Theseus's nuptial day. The shallowest thick skin of this barren sort presented Pyramus in their sport, forsook his scene and entered in a break, when I did him at disadvantage take. An ass's knoll I fixed on his head. Anon, his Thisby must be answered, and forth my mimic comes. When they him spy, as wild geese the creeping fowler eye, so at his sight away his fellows fly. At our stampede, over and over one falls. He murder cries, and help from Athens calls. I led them on in this distracted fear, and left sweet Pyramus translated there. When in that moment, so it came to pass, Titania waked, and straightway loved an ass.
This falls out better than I could devise. But hast thou yet latched the Athenian's eyes with the love juice, as I bid thee do?
I took him sleeping, that is finished too, and the Athenian woman by his side, that when he waked, of force she must be I.
Stay close, this is the same Athenian.
This is the woman, but not this the man. Oh, why rebuke you him that loves you so? Lay breath so bitter on your bitter foe.
Now I but chide, but I should see worse, for thou, I fear, hast given me cause to curse. If thou hast slain Lysander in his sleep, be your shoes in blood and plunge in the deep, and kill me too. The sun was not so true unto the day as he to me. When he has stolen away from sleeping Hermia, I'll believe, as soon this whole earth may be born, and that the moon may through her center creep, and so displease her brother's new ties with the Antipodes. It cannot be but thou hast murdered him. So should a murderer look, so dead, so grim.
So should the murderer look, and so should I, pierced to the heart with your stern cruelty. Yet you, the murderer, look as bright, as clear, as yonder Venus in her glimmering sphere.
What's this to my Lysander? Where is he? Ah, good Demetrius, wilt thou give him me?
I'd rather give his carcass to my hounds.
Out, dog! Out, cur! Thou drivest me past the bounds of Phoenix patience! Hast thou slain him then? Oh, henceforth be never numbered among men. Oh, what? Tell true, even for my sake. Durst thou have looked upon him being waked, and hast thou killed him sleeping? Oh, brave touch! Be not a word an adder do so much. An adder did it, for with doubler tongue, then thine, thou serpent, never adder stung.
You do spend your passion on a misprized mood. I am not guilty of Lysander's blood, nor is he dead, for aught that I can tell.
I pray thee, tell me then that he is well.
And if I could, what would I get there for?
A crib would never see me more, and from thy hated presence part I so. See me no more, whether he be dead or no!
There is no following her in this fierce vein. Here, therefore, for a while I will remain. So sorrow's heaviness doth have here grow. For sleep the debt sleep doth sorrow, which now, in some slight measure, it will pay. If, for its tender, here, I make some stay.
What hast thou done? Thou was mistaken quite, and laid the love juice on some true love's sight. Of thy misprison must perforce ensue a true love turned, but not a false turned true.
Then fate overrules, for one man holding troth, a million fail, confounding oath on earth.
About the wood go swifter than the wind. In Helena of Athens look thou fine, all fancy 6 years and pale of cheer, sighs of love that cost the fresh blood dear. By some illusions bring her here, and all charm against his eyes she do appear.
I go, I go, look how I go, swifter than the arrow from the Tartar's bow.
Flower of his purple dye, hit with Cupid's archery, sink in the apple of his eye. When his love he doth espy, let her shine as gloriously as the Venus of his sky. When thou wak'st, if she be by, beg of her for a remedy.
Captain of our fairy band, Helena is here at hand, and the youth mistook by me, pleading for a lover's fee. Shall we their fond pageant see? Lord, what fools these mortals be! Stand aside, the noise they make will cause Demetrius to wake. Then will two at once woo one? This must needs be sport alone. And those things do best please me that should fall preposterously.
Why should you think that I should woo in scorn? If scorn and derision ever come to tears? Look, when I vow I weep, and vows so born in their nativity, all truth appears. How can these things in me seem scorned, and bearing the badge of faith to prove them true?
You do advance your cunning more and more. When truth kills truth, oh, devilish holy prey! These vows are Hermia's. Will you give her over? Wait, oath with oath, and you will nothing weigh. Your vows to her and me, put in two scales, will even weigh, and both in the lightest tails.
I have no judgment to her, I swore.
Nor none now, you give her over.
Demetrius loves her, and loves not you.
Oh, Helen, goddess, nymph, perfect, divine. To what, my love, shall I compare thine eye? Crystalless, money, oh, how ripened show thy lips, those kissing cherries tempting grow. That pure, congealed white, high Taurus snow, turns to a crow when thou holdest up thy hand. Oh, let me kiss this princess of pure white, this seal of bliss.
Oh, spite! Oh, hell! As you're all bent to set against me in your merriment. If you were civil and knew courtesy, you would not do me thus much injury. Can you not hate me, as I know you do, but you must join in souls to mock me too? If you were men, as men you are in show, you would not use a gentle lady so, to vow and swear and to praise my parts, when I'm sure you hate me with all your hearts. You are both rivals and love Hermia. Now both rivals to mock Helena, a trim exploit, a manly enterprise, to conjure up tears in a poor maid's eyes with your derision. None of noble sort would so offend a virgin, and extort a poor soul's patience, all to make you sport.
You are unkind, Demetrius. Be not so, for you love Hermia. This you know I know. And here, with all goodwill and with all my heart, in Hermia's love I yield you on my power. And yours is Helena to me bequeath, whom I do love and will do till my death.
Never did mockers waste such idle breath.
Lysander, keep thy Hermia. I will none. If ever I loved her, all that love is gone. My heart to her but is guestwise sojourned, and now to Helen his home returns, here to remain. Helen, it is not so. Disparage not the faith thou dost not know, lest to thy peril thou abide it dear. Look where thy love comes. Yonder is thy dear.
Oh, dark night! Oh, thou art not by mine eye, Lysander, found! Mine ear, I think, have brought me to thy sound. But why unkindly dost thou leave me so?
Why should he stay when love doth press to go?
What love could press Lysander from my side?
Lysander's love, it would not let him by. Fair Helen, who more yields than nightly, all yon fiery hopes and eyes of light. Why seekest thou? Could this not make thee know the hate I bear thee made me leave thee so?
You speak not as a thing it cannot be.
Lo, she is one of this confederacy. Now I perceive they have been joined all three to fashion this false sport in spite of me. Injurious Hermia, most ungrateful maid, have you conspired? Have you with these contrived to bait me with this foul derision? Is all the time that we two have spent, all sisters' vows, the hours we two have shared, when we have chided the hasty put in time for parting us? Oh, is it all forgot? All school days' friendship, childhood innocence? Will you rent our ancient love asunder to join with men in scorning your poor friend? 'Tis not friendly, 'tis not maidenly. Our sex, as well as I, do chide you for it, though I alone do feel the injury.
I am amazed at your passionate words. I scorn you not, it seems that you scorn me.
Have you not set Lysander, as in scorn, to follow me and praise my eyes and face, and made your other love, Demetrius, who even but now did spurn me with his foot, to call me goddess, nymph, divine, and rare, precious, celestial? Wherefore speaks he this to her he hates? And wherefore doth Lysander deny your love,
so rich within his soul to tender me for soothe affection, but by your setting on, by your consent. What though I be not so embraced, so hung upon love, so fortunate, but miserable most, to love unloved. This you should pity rather than despise.
I understand not what you mean by this.
I do persevere, counterfeit sad looks, make mouths upon me when I turn my back, wink at each other, hold the sweet jest up. This sport, well carried, shall be chronicled. If you had any pity, grace, or manners, you would not make me such an argument. But fare you well. 'Tis partly my fault, which death or absence soon shall remedy.
Stay, gentle Helena, hear my excuse. My love, my life, my soul, fair Helena.
Oh, excellent.
Sweet, do not scorn herself.
If she cannot entreat, I can compel.
Compel? Thou can compel no more than she entreat. Thy threats have no more strength than her weak prayers. Helena, I love thee. By my life I do. I swear by that which I will lose for thee. To prove him false that says I love thee.
I say I love thee more than he can do.
Thou say so, withdraw. I prove it to you. Quick, come.
Lysander, where's your tangle?
Away, me feel.
Take on it, you follow. But yet, come not. You are a tame man. Go.
Hang off, thou cat, thou bird, vile thing. Let loose. I will shake thee from me like a serpent.
Why do you grow so rude? What change is this to be love?
Thy love. Out! Tired, loathed, medicine, hated pleasure, hence, get out!
Do you not jest?
Yes, he does, and so do you.
Demetrius, I'll keep my word with thee.
I would I had your bond, for I perceive a weak bond holds you. I'll not trust your word.
What? Should I hurt her? Strike her? Kill her dead? Although I hate her, I'll not harm her so.
What? Can you do me greater harm than hate? Hate me? Wherefore, oh me, what news, my love? Not I, Hermia? Are not you, Lysander? I can despair now as I was ere while. Since night you left me, why then you left me? Oh, the gods forbid, in earnest shall I
say. Ah! Never the desire to see you more. Therefore, be out of hope, out of question, doubt, be certain. Nothing truer. I hate you.
Oh,
I love how you.
You juggler! You cake and blossom! You thief of love! What? Have you come by night and stolen my love's heart from him?
Fine! In faith! Have you no modesty? No maiden shame? No touch of bashfulness? Will you tear impatient answers from my gentle tongue? Fie, fie, you counterfeit you. Puppet, you.
Puppet? Why so? Aye, that way goes the game. Now I perceive she hath made compare between our statures. Oh, she hath urged her height, and with her personage, her tall personage, her high pursuit, she hath prevailed with him. And are you grown so high in his esteem because I am so dwarfish and so low? How low am I, thou painted maypole? Speak! How low am I? I am not yet so low, but that my nails joint up my eyes!
I pray you, though you mock me, gentlemen, let her not hurt me. You may think me something lower than myself. I can match her.
Lower! Perfect! Yes!
Do not be so bad. I am born to love you, Hermia. Did ever keep your counsels? Never wronged you? Save that in love to Demetrius, I told him of yourself into this wood. He followed you, for love I followed him. But he hath chided me hence, and threatened to spurn me, strike me, nay, to kill me too. And so you left me alone, and I followed back and followed you no more. Let me go!
Why get you gone? Who is it that hinders you?
A foolish heart. That I leave you behind.
What? With Lysander?
With Demetrius.
Be not afraid. She will not harm you, fair Helena.
No, sir, she shall not, though you take her part.
Oh, when she's angry, she's keen and shrewd. She was a vixen when she went to school. And though she be but little, she is fierce.
Little again! Nothing but little and little! Why will you suffer her to love me thus? Let me come to her!
Get you gone, you dwarf! You nimbus! You kindred and not grass maid! You bee, you acorn!
You are too officious in her behalf that to scorn your services. Let her alone, in her. Speak not of Helena. Take not her part. For, if thou dost intend never so little show of love to her, thou shalt abide.
Now she holds me not. Therefore follow, if thou darest. Strive's right. Of thine or mine is most in Helena.
Follow? Nay, I'll go with thee. Cheek by jowl!
You mistress! All this toil is long of you. Nay, go not back.
I will not trust you. I nor long can stay your cursed company. Your hands than mine are quicker for a fray. My legs are longer, though, to run away.
I am amazed. I know not what to say.
This is thy negligence. Still thou mistakest, or else committest thy knaveries willfully.
Believe me, King of Shadows, I mistook. Did not you tell me I should know the man by the Athenian garments he had on? It so far blameless proves my enterprise that I have anointed an Athenian's eyes. And so far, I am glad it did so sort me. For this, their jangling, I esteem a sport.
Thou seest these lovers seek a place to fight. Aye, therefore, Robin, overcast the night, and lead these testy rivals so astray, as one not come within the other's way. Like to Lysander, frame thy tongue, then stir Demetrius up with bitter wrong. Sometime rail thou like Demetrius, and from each other lead them thus, till over their brows death counterfeit in sleep, with leaden legs and batty wings doth creep. Then crush this herb into Lysander's eye, whose liquor hath such virtuous property, to take from thence all error with his might, and make his eyeballs roll with wanting sight. Then, when the next wake, all this derision will seem such a dream and fruitless vision. While in this affair I do thee employ, I'll to my queen and beg the Indian boy, and then from charmed eye release from monster's view, all things shall be peace.
My fairy king, this must be done with haste, for night's dragons cut the clouds full fast, and yonder shines Aurora's harbinger, at whose approach ghosts wandering here and there troop home to churchyards, damned spirits all.
But we're spirits of a different sort. I, with the morning's love, have oft made sport. But notwithstanding haste, make no delay. We may effect this business yet ere day.
Up and down, up and down. I will lead them up and down. I'm feared and feel the town. Goblin, lead them up and down. Here comes one.
Where art thou, proud Demetrius? Speak thou now.
Here, villain, drawn and ready. Where art thou?
I will be with thee straight.
Follow me then, to plainer ground.
Lysander, speak again. Thou coward, thou runaway, art thou fled? Speak, in some bush, where dost thou hide thy head?
Thou coward, art thou bragging to the stars? Telling the bushes that thou look'st for wars and wilt not come? Come, recreant, come, thy child, I'll whip thee with a rod. He is defiled that draws a sword on thee. Yea, art thou there? Follow my voice, we'll try no manhood here.
He goes before me, and then he is gone. When I come where he calls, then he leaves. The villain is much lighter heeled than I. I follow faster than fly. Fallen am I in dark and uneven way. And here we'll wrestle. Come, thou gentle day. For if but once thou show me that great light, I'll find Demetrius and avenge this spite.
Coward, why comest thou not? A
abide me. If thou darest, for well I wot, thou runnest before me, and shifting in every place, and darest not stand nor look me in the face. Where art thou now? Come hither, I am here. Nay then, thou mockest me. Thou shalt buy this dear if ever I thy face by daylight see.
No, go thy way. Faintness constraineth me to measure out my length. Oh, by this cold bed. Oh, my day's approach not to be visited.
Oh, weary night. Oh, long and tedious night. Abate thy hours and shine comforts from the east that I be back to Athens my daylight.
Yet but three? Come one more. Two of both kinds makes up four. Here she comes, cursed and sad. Cupid is a knavish lad, thus to make poor females mad.
Never so weary, never so in woe, bedabbled with the dew and torn with briars. I can no farther crawl, no further go. My legs can keep no pace with my desires. Here will I rest me till the break of day. Heaven shield my standard thing in a fray.
On the ground, sleep sound. I'll apply to thy eye, gentle lover, remedy. And when thou wakest, thou takest true delight in the sight of thy former lady's eye. And the country proverb known, that every man shall take his own, and in your waking shall be shown, Jack shall have Jill, naught shall go ill. The man shall have his mare again, and all shall be well.
Come, sit thee down upon my flowery bed, while I thy amiable cheeks
enjoy,
and stick musk roses in thy sleek, smooth head, and kiss thy fair, large ears, my gentle joy.
Where's Pease Blossom?
Ready?
Scratch my head, Pease Blossom. Where's Modsware Cobweb?
Ready.
Modsware Cobweb. Eeyah! Good Modsware. Get you your weapons in hand and kill me a red-hipped humblebee from on top of a thistle. And good Modsware, have a care, bring me the honey bag. And do not fret yourself too much in the action, good Modsware. And good Modsware, have a care, the honey bag break not. For I would loathe but to eeyah! But to have you overflow with the honey bag, senor. Where's Modsware Mustard Seed? Give me your neef, good Modsware. I pray you leave your courtesy.
What's your will?
Nothing. Eeyah! But to help Calvary Cobweb to scratch, I must to the barber's, for I am marvelous hairy about the face, and I am such a tender ass. If my hair do but tickle me, I must scratch.
What?
Eeyah!
Wilt thou hear some music, my sweet love?
I have reasonable good ear in music. Let's have the tongs and the bones.
Or say, sweet love, what thou desirest to eat.
Truly a peck of provender. I could munch your good dry oats, but methinks I have a great desire to a bottle of hay. Eeyah! Sweet hay. Eeyah! Half old fellow.
I have a venturous fairy who will seek the squirrel's hoard and fetch thee new nuts.
I'd rather a handful or two of dried peas, but I pray you let none of your people stir me, for methinks I have an exposition of sleep come upon me.
Sleep then, wind thee in my arms.
Fairies, away, and be all ways away.
So doth the woodbine, the sweet honeysuckle, gently entwist. The female ivy so enrings the barky fingers of the elm. How I love thee! How I dote on thee!
Welcome, good Robin. Seest thou this sweet sight? Her dotage now I do begin to pity, for meeting her of late behind this wood and seeking sweet hay and favors from this hateful fool. I did upbraid her and fall out with her. Then at my pleasure I taunted her. She in mild terms begged my patience. I then did ask for the changeling child, which straight she gave me, and her fairy sent to my bower in fairyland. Now that I have the boy, I will undo this hateful imperfection on his eyes. My gentle pluck, take the head off this Athenian swain, that he waking when the other do, may all to Athens back again repair, and think no more of this night's accidents, but as the fierce vexation of a dream. But first I must wake the queen. Be'st thou was wont to be, see'st thou was wont to see, Diane's bud over Cupid flower, hath such force and blessed power. Now, my Titania, wake me, my sweet queen.
Oh, my Oberon, what visions have I seen? Methought I was enamored of an ass.
There lies your love.
Oh! How came these things to pass? Oh, how my eyes do loathe this visage now.
Silence a while. Puck, take the head off this Athenian swain. Titania, music call, and strike more dead than all these common sleep of all these five descents.
Music, oh, music, such as charmeth sleep.
Now when thou wakest, with thine own fool's eyes peep. Come, my queen, take hands with me, and rock the ground where all these sleepers be. Now thou and I are new in amity, and will tomorrow, midnight solemnly, dance into Theseus' house triumphantly. And bless to all fair prosperity, there will the pairs of faithful lovers be, wedded with Theseus, all in jolly. My fairy king, attend and hark, I do hear the morning lark. Come, my queen, in silence sad, chirp we after the night's shade, we the globe can compass soon, swifter than the wandering moon.
Come, my lord, in inner flight, tell me how it came this night that I, sleeping here, was found with these mortals on the ground.
Go, one of you, find out the forester. My love shall hear the music of my hounds. Dispatch, I say, find the forester.
You will, fair queen, go up to the mountain's top and rock the musical confusion of hounds and echo in conjunction.
I was with Hercules and Cadmus once, when in a wood of Crete they bayed the bear with hounds of Sparta. Never have I heard such gallant chiding, for besides the groves, the skies, the fountains, every region seemed all one mutual cry. I never heard so musical a discord, such sweet thunder.
Well, my hounds are brought out of the Spartan kind, so flute, so scented, and their heads are hung with ears that sweep away the morning dew. A cry more tunable was never hollered to, nor cheered with horn in Crete, nor Sparta, nor Thessaly. Judge when you hear. But soft! What nymphs are these?
My lord, this is my daughter here asleep. And this Lysander. And this Demetrius? This Helma? Old Leather's Helma? I wonder of them being here together.
Well, no doubt they rose up early to observe the rite of May, and hearing our intent to set to grace of our solemnity. But speak, Aegeus, is not this the day that Hermia should get answer of her choice?
It is, my lord.
Go, bid the huntsmen wake them with their horns. Good morrow, friends. Saint Valentine is past. Begin but these woodbirds with a couple now. I pray you all stand up. I know you two are rival enemies. How comes this gentle concord in the world that hatred is so far from jealousy to sleep by hate and fear no enmity?
My lord, I shall reply amazingly. Half asleep, half waking. But as yet I cannot truly say how I came here. But as I think, for truly what I speak, and now I do bethink me, so it is. I came with Hermia hither. It was our intent to be gone from Athens. What would be without the peril of the Athenian law?
Enough. Enough, my lord. You have enough. I beg the law. The law upon his head. They won't so away. They won't. Demetrius! Thereby defeating you and me, you of your wife and me, and my consent that she shall be your wife.
My lord, fair Helen told me of their stealth, of this their purpose hither to the wood, and I in fury hither followed them, fair Helen in fancy following me. But, my good lord, I know not by what power, but some power it is, my love to Hermia. Melted as the snow, seems to me now as the remembrance of an idle toy which in my childhood I did dote upon. And all the faith, the virtue of my heart, the object and pleasure of mine eye, is only Helena. To her, my lord, was I betrothed before I saw Hermia. But, like in sickness, did I loathe this food. But, as in health, come to my natural taste, I do wish it, love it, long for it, and will forevermore be true to it.
Fair lovers, you are fortunately met. Of this discourse, we more will hear anon. Aegeus, I will overbear your will. For in the temple bind by with us, these couple shall eternally be knit. Morning now is something worn, our purpose something shall be set aside. Away with us to Athens, 3 and 3. We'll hold a feast in great solemnity.
Come and come. These things seem small and indistinguishable.
I think I see things as part of that, and everything seems double.
So do I. And I have found Demetrius like a jewel. Mine own, and...
Are you sure that we are awake? It seems to me that yet we sleep, we dream. Do you not think that the Duke was here and bid us follow him?
Yes, and my father.
And Hippolyta?
And he did bid us follow to the temple.
Why then, we are awake. Let us follow him, and by the way, recount our dreams.
When my cue comes, call me and I will answer. My next is most fair Pyramus. Hi-ho, Peter Quince, Starveling, Snout, Flute. God's my life. Stolen pence and left me asleep. I've had a most rare vision. I've had a dream. Pastor would have meant to say what dream it was. He thought I was... There's no man can tell what. Man is but an ass if you go about to expound this dream. Methought I was, and methought I had. Man is but a patched fool if he will often say what methought I had. The eye of man hath not heard, the ear of man hath not seen. Man's hand not able to taste, nor his tongue to conceive, nor his heart to report what my dream was. I will get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream. And it shall be called Bottom's Dream, because it hath no bottom. And I shall sing it in the latter end of the play before the Duke. And to make it the more gracious, I shall sing it at his death.
Lost sixpence a day during his life. He could not have scraped sixpence a day. And the Duke had not given him I'll be hanged. Sixpence a day of heroes or nothing.
Where are these lads? Where are these hearts?
Otto, almost courageous day, almost happy hour.
Masters, I am to this source of wonders. But ask me not what, for if I tell you, I am no true Athenian. I will tell you everything right as it fell out.
Let us hear, sweet Bottom.
Not a word of me. All I will tell you is that the Duke hath died. Get your apparel together. Meet presently at the palace. Every man look over his part. For the short and the long is our play is preferred. In any case, let this be have clean linen. And let not she who plays the lion's part count her nails, for they are to hang out as the lion's claws. And most dear actors, eat no onions nor garlic, for we are to utter sweet breath, and I do not doubt but to hear them say, it is a sweet garlic. No more words. Away! Go away!
Strange than true. I never may believe these antique fables nor these fairy toys. Lovers and madmen have such exceeding brains, such shaping fantasies that apprehend more than cool reason ever comprehends. The lot of the lunatic, the lover, and the poet, of imagination all compact. Oh, such tricks have strong imagination that if it but apprehends some joy, it comprehends a bringer of that joy. Or in the night imagining some fear, how easy is a bush supposed to bear?
But all the story of the night told over, and all their minds transfigured so together, more witness it than fancy's images, and grows to something of great consistency. What, howsoever, strange, yet admirable.
Here come the lovers of joy and mirth. Joy, gentle friends. Joy and fresh days of love accompany your hearts.
More than to us waiting your royal walks, your board, and your bed.
Come now, what masks, what dances shall we have to wear away this long age of 3 hours between our after supper and bedtime? Where is our usual manager of mirth? What brows are in hand? Is there no play to ease the anguish of a torturing hour? Call Philostrates.
Here, my Odysseus.
Oh, there you are. Say, what abridgment have you for this evening?
There is a brief. Sports are right. Make choice of what your hands receive first.
The Battle of the Centaurs will be sung by an Athenian eunuch to the harp. Well, we'll have none of that. That I have told my love. In glory of my kinsman Hercules. The riot of the tipsy Bacchanals, tearing the Thracian singer in their rage. All that is an old device. It was played when I from Thebes gave my conqueror. The thrice three muses, mourning for the death of learning. Late deceased in beggary, all that is some satire. Keen and critical, yet not sorting with the nuptial ceremony. A tedious brief scene of young Pyramus and his love Thisbe. Very tragical mirth. Well, merry and tragical, tedious and brief. That is hot ice and wondrous strange snow. How shall we find the concord of this discord?
A play there is, my lord, some 10 words long. But which is as brief as I've gone to play. By 10 words, my lord, it's too long, which makes it tedious. For in all the play, there's not one word apt, one player suited, and tragical, my noble lord, it is. For Pyramus then does kill himself, which I must confess, when I saw hers, made my eyes water, but more merry tears, attached to wild laughter never shed.
What are they that do play it?
High schoolers who study in Athens here, which never labored in their minds until now.
And we will hear it.
No, my noble lord, it is not for you. I've heard it over, and it is nothing, nothing in the world, unless you can find sport in their tents, extremely stretched and conned with cruel pain, to do you service.
No, I will hear this play. For never anything can be amiss when simpleness and duty tender it. Go, bring them in, and take your places, ladies.
I love not to see wretchedness or charge, nor duty in the service perishing.
Well, I, gentle sweet, shall see no such thing.
He says they can do nothing of this kind.
Well, the kind are we to give up things for nothing.
Our sport shall be to take what they mistake and what poor duty cannot do. Noble respect takes it in might, not merit.
Suppose you, Grace. The prologue is addressed.
Let her approach.
Not to offend, but with good will. To show our simple skill, that is the true beginning of our end. Consider this, we come but in despite you. As minded to content you, our true intent is. All for your delight, we are not here. That you should here repent you, that actors are at hand, and by their show you shall know all that you would like to know.
This prologue does not stand upon points.
She hath ridden her prologue like a rough colt. She knows not the stock. A good moral, my lord. It's not enough to speak, but to speak truth.
Indeed, she hath put it on this prologue like a child on a recorder. A sound, but not in government.
Her speech was like a tangled chain. Nothing impaired, but all disordered. Who was next?
Gentles, perchance you wonder at this show. But wonder on till truth make all things plain. This man is pyramid, if you would know. This beauteous lady is certain. This man presenteth moonshine, presenteth wall. And through love false chain did these lovers think to whisper, I wish that no man wonder. This one, with lanthorn dog and bush of thorn, presenteth moonshine. By moonshine did these lovers think no scorn, to meet at Nina's tomb, there to woo. This grisly beast, by which name lion hight, and trusty Thisbe coming first by night, did scare away, or rather did affright, and as she fled, her mantle she did fall. And by lion's vile bloody mouth did stain. Anon comes Pyramus, sweet youth and tall, finds trusty Thisbe's mantle slain. Whereat with blade, this bloody, blameful blade, he bravely broached his boiling bloody breast. Mulberry shade. All dressed as lion, moonshine, wall, and lovers twain. Marches first, yet he do remain.
Lion be to speak.
What a lion name, my lord, when many asses do.
You say, Midsummer, it doth befall that I, one snout, by name present wall. And such a wall that I would have you think that in it had a cranny hole or chink, through which the lovers, Pyramus and Thisbe, did often whisper very secret. This loam, this rough cast, and this stone doth show that I and the same wall, the truth is so. And this cranny is right and sinister, through which the lovers are to whisper.
Would you desire brick and mortar to speak better?
It is the wittiest partition, Lord, that I have ever heard discourse.
Pyramus draws near the wall. Silence.
Night. Whole night with Hughes. Whole night, whichever art, when day is not. Whole night.
Whole night.
Alack, alack, alack.
lovely wall that stands between her father's ground and mine. That wall. Oh, wall. Oh, sweet and lovely wall. Show me thy cheek to blink with mine eye. Thanks, courteous wall. Jumpsuit you up for this. But what see I? No Thisbe do I see. Oh, wicked wall! For whom I see no bliss. Cursed be thy stones for thus deceiving me.
The wall methinks being sensible should curse again.
No, truth, sir, we should not. Deceiving me is Thisbe's cue. She is to enter now, and I can spy her through the wall. You shall see. It will fall back. Yonder she comes!
Oh, wall.
Was so true.
Oh,
Well run, Thisbe!
Well shown, Moon. Truly the moon shines with a good grace.
Well, Mouse Lion.
And then King Caramus.
Sweet Moon, I thank thee for thy sunny beams. I thank thee, Moon, for shining now so bright. For by thy gracious, golden, glittering gleams, I trust to take of truest Thisbe's sight. But stay, O spite. But mark, poor knight, what dreadful dole is here. Eyes, do you see? How can it be? O dainty duck, O dear, thy mantle good, approach ye fervent spell. O fate, come, cut, thread and thrum, quail, crush, conclude, and quell.
The death of a dear friend would go near to make a man look sad.
Beshrew my heart, but I pity the man.
Oh, wherefore, nature, didst thou lion's frame? Since lion wild hath here deflowered my dear, which was the fairest name? That lived, that loved, that liked, that looked with cheer. Come, tears confound, out sword and wound, the pack of Pyramus, I, the left pack. Thus die I, thus. Now I am dead, now I am fled, my soul is in the sky, tongue lose thy light, move. Take thy flight. Now, die. Die!
Than an ace, man, for he's dead.
Well, with the help of a surgeon, he might yet recover and prove an ass.
How chance Moonshine is gone before Thisbe comes back and finds her lover?
Well, she will find him by starlight. Here she comes, and her passion ends the play.
Very nobly discharged. But
Pleasure, Pelagolo. The iron tongue of midnight has told 12. Lovers to bed, 'tis almost fairy time. I fear we shall outsleep the coming morn, as much as we the sand have overwatched. This probable gross play hath well begot the heavy gate of night. Sweet friends, to bed. A fortnight we hold in the solemnity, in nightly revels, and new jollity.
Now the hungry lion roars, and the wolf behowls the moon, whilst the heavy plowman snores, all with weary task fordone. Now it is the time of night that the graves, all gaping wide, every one lets forth its sprite in the churchway paths to glide. And we spirits that do run by the triple Hecate's team, from the presence of the sun, following darkness like a dream, now our frolic. Not a mouse shall disturb this hallowed house. I am sent with broom before to sweep the dust behind the door.
Through this house give gathering light, by the dead and drowsy fire. Come each elf and fairy sprite, and hop as light as bird from briar. And this ditty after me, sing and dance it trippingly.
First rehearse your song by rote, to each word a warbling note. Hand in hand with fairy grace, will we dance and bless this place.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone.
Gentles, do not reprehend. If you pardon, we will mend. And as I am an honest puck, think but this. If we have unearned luck now to escape the serpent's tongue, we will make amends all ere long, or else the puck a liar call. So good night unto you all. Give me your hands if we be friends.